We have reached our pollution equilibrium, where we are outputting pollution at the same rate as the terrain is sustainably absorbing it. I say we are good to go ahead on our final dash of destruction, to finally start actively pursuing our goals and dreams of world peace. Well, well, well. Fair warning, this episode ain't for the faint of heart. If you think biters are cute and adorable, this ain't the episode for you, my friend. Because with pollution minimized and our green base running at full speed, we can start preparing for the grand master plan with a biblical barbecue which will smite biter and bot alike. But first, we call all dormant bots back from the walls. The logistics bots by enforcing a giant wood transfer. And the construction bots by our pipe recaller 3000. Unfortunately, the 100 oil stored in each and every flamethrower cannot be reclaimed. But for the rest, we have pumped nearly all oil out of our old inner wall, so we can disconnect the pumps. Then the time has finally come to start expanding our tileable nuclear reactor. But why? Weren't we done with base building stuff? Why, yes we are. Who said we need this power for base building? Anyway, let's stamp down the blueprint and... Wait, why can't we place the second one? Oh. Well, not having to deal with manually connecting pumps and pipes is exactly the reason we built this reactor on the water. Actually, I think we want to disconnect the new extension from the existing power plant. Since all the new reactors and heat pipes will be installed at room temperature, we risk giving the running reactor a huge cold shock, as all the heat will spread to the new reactor, possibly causing a blackout if the running reactor's temperature drops below 500 degrees. And indeed, even after letting the new reactor preheat itself to 500 degrees before connecting it to the existing power plant, we still get a near instant 250 degree temperature drop. That may have been a good call. Strangely enough, I fear that doubling the reactor still may not give us enough power. What the heck are we going to need so much power for then? This isn't space exploration after all. Anyway, so after just doubling up from 20 to 40 reactors, we prepare more land in order to be able to double up yet again to 80 reactors. We fully filled a large area with landfill again, so you know what that means. It is time to start producing atomic bombs. Anyway, doubling the reactor also means we will produce twice as much spent fuel cells, so we need to increase nuclear fuel reprocessing too. The new centrifuges are out of reach of the beacons though, so in order to comply with the minus 80% pollution rule, they get outfitted with Mark II efficiency modules. There, that should do the trick. Meanwhile, our uranium reserves are looking respectable again, and while the mine is slowly dwindling, I think we can stretch this single uranium source until the end of the playthrough. Okay, dude, what are you doing? Your base was running fine on 20 reactors, but you doubled up to 40 anyway with your mysterious power-hungry project. Then you prepared space for 80 reactors, and now we're up to space for 120? You better tell us what the heck is going on. Alright, let's check out our power draw then, huh? See man, it's all beacons and... Wow, you have over 1000 raiders up in your base, man. But still, that's only 300 megawatts or like 2 reactors worth of power. I still don't get it. Wait, why do we have 3 full chests of raiders? Well, now we are going to have to work outside of our walls, behind the for us uncrossable hazard concrete border. It would kind of suck if we didn't get to see much of the action due to the fog of war, right? So, to remedy that, I've decided we may need to place a few extra raiders. And by a few, I mean I crammed as much raiders in our wall design as I could fit, which turns out to be 36 raiders. But dude, wouldn't it be smarter to stretch out those raiders a bit, instead of dropping a few chunks like that here and there? Well, my man, there is nothing to stretch out. We are going to upgrade every single wall chunk with 36 raiders each. And we have a lot of wall. That's another 2000 raiders on the north wall alone. Now, carefully look at the raider scan rate in the northern chunks as the bots start adding all the raiders. Yeah boys, Big Brother is gonna be watching you! But yeah, that is a stupid amount of raiders indeed. Now we just need to add 3 times that amount for the other 3 walls. And as the bots place the raiders on the other 3 walls, watch the raider scan rate go wild all over the map now. Man oh man, after seeing this result, only one thought comes to mind. It's not enough. Come on bots, let's hurry up with that nuclear power plant production. While we wait for that, there's a 2 chunk wide area between my old and my new wall, which is outside the always visible reach of my raiders. So let's work on permanently lighting up those chunks with a new self-expanding band of raiders and roboports around my base. That will make sure the raiders at the front wall won't have to work scanning those chunks in the back anymore. And it's done! The whole area within our new walls is now nicely lit up. And the massive raider blocks on the walls can now spend their full power on scanning the distant, biter-ridden chunks. The recently expanded nuclear reactor is already running at max capacity again, as now we have 10,000 raiders scanning the fields of biters, and raiders have even overtaken beacons as the number one power consumer. Still, there's only one thought. It's not enough. So, we are going to need more power still. No wait, don't build it yet. The landfill hasn't been properly prepared yet. Oh well, I guess he'll find out soon. So indeed, we gotta go and enrich the landfill for the nuclear reactor with some nice nuclear explosions. That will cause the landfill to green up in multiple ways, most importantly causing it to start absorbing some pollution. First, let's deconstruct this RoboPort to separate networks, so that there are no construction bots in the local nuclear power network. Yeah, now he finds out. You can put the nuclear reactor on the explosion scorch mark, but you cannot put the scorch mark under a running nuclear reactor. Well, you can try, but the explosion will be a little larger than anticipated. Nuclear reactors explode like atomic bombs when destroyed, causing a chain reaction which takes out the whole power plant. So, let's not do that. First, we deconstruct the power and RoboPort skeleton which the bots needed to place all the landfill. Then we tell the bots to start dismantling running parts of a superheated active nuclear reactor. Well, that's probably not in accordance with the safety regulations. Well, nothing exploded yet, so let's get rid of those turbines too then. And we're back to our old power level. Meanwhile, I can nicely illustrate why we're executing this strange ritual. Before we had a green base, the nuclear reactor was covered in pollution. But now with the green base, the pollution cloud has shrunk and the skies above the nuclear reactor are pollution free again. All thanks to our nuke the landfill ritual. Without that procedure, an eternal and immovable cloud of pollution.
Dude, so you keep going on and on and on about that. So there must be some great benefit for the base for doing all that work, right?
Right? Of course. It looks nicer on the map. My dear guy, you have been putting us through this nuking procedure spread out over several episodes, all for it looks nicer on the map? Well, at least try to make it look spectacular then. Whoa man, okay, maybe not that spectacular. Okay, so let's take personal safety a bit more serious then. Good job. On a side note, if you can spot the serious mistake I'm making right now, you're a lot smarter than me. Okay, blowing up this chunk is probably still safe. No, it wasn't. Not by a long shot too, mate. Okay, that chunk definitely is not safe to nuke then, mate. After your previous underestimation, you should now realize that the hot nuclear reactor is too close, mate. No, don't do it! Hey, Trillahex, there's not even a scratch on the reactor. Well, the rest of the process goes without further incidents. Even I am not thick-headed enough to make the same mistake twice. And soon we are rebuilding the last part of the power plant. Well, except for the 185 elements we blew up, of course, they are still missing. So we are done. Let's reconnect the RoboPort network so the base bots can rebuild the full nuclear plant then.
All in all, I would say this was a very successful mission. Our Spidertron suffered but a scratch, and we were a safe margin of several centimeters away from blowing up our whole nuclear reactor. Well, no pain, no gain. Even though the gain is purely cosmetic. We decide to go big or go home. And since I'm stuck on this planet, I ain't going home. So we add a fourth block to the reactor, which essentially doubles our doubled power output. So then, with all that available power, what are we going to build next? Well, the logical thing to do is to deconstruct all of our 10,000 raiders? What? Okay, I give up. Where's the logic in that then? Yeah, I don't know who's writing the script. Oh, now he's typing to us. Okay, I see. So, by using the single keystroke of Ctrl-Z, we are basically giving the order to place back 10,000 raiders at the same time, which leads to the raiders being built everywhere at the same time, instead of placing them in blocks. This is important to us, as we are not using the raiders to scan new terrain. Our goal for the raiders is to fully and permanently reveal all the chunks they normally slowly scan one by one. And since they only grant vision on a faraway chunk for a few seconds of every half minute scan interval, it is important that the raiders are not placed in bulk sections, but more organically, sprinkled around like snowflakes everywhere at the same time. But we didn't have enough raiders to permanently reveal all terrain just yet, so while all the bots are still flooded in work, we redesigned the raider wall blueprint to add a few more raiders to the front. And I've added another two rows of raiders to the blueprint off-cam, basically doubling our previous raider count. And that eventually leads to...
Attention Biters of Novis. You now live in a surveillance state. All your privacy belongs to us. Attention Biters of Novis. You now live in a surveillance state. All your privacy belongs to us.
Yes, indeed. We now have uninterrupted full satellite view on the entire planet of Novis. But man, was that really necessary? Well, yes, my man. We are making a video series, aren't we? We are going to be spending most of the finale looking far beyond our borders, in the area normally obscured by the fog of war. Wouldn't it be nice to be able to actually see what we will be doing out there? Well, with 20,000 raiders pulling 6 gigawatts of power, now we can. You know, normal people would just install a mod for that. Okay, so vision mission complete. We can have a normal player amount of stashed raiders again then, yes? Now we just need a small test project to try out our new satellite radar view. And if you remember, our new outer wall is now placed almost directly against the biters. Then you will understand why I'm standing at my 4 artillery trains. We have over 100,000 artillery shells ready to deal with all of this. So far we have destroyed 88,000 biter bases and worms. Will we have enough? Only one way to find out. So we send over the trains. And watch the show. Well, if the biters won't kill my base, they will fry my computer. My UPS is not liking this at all. All four trains have spent their 2,000 shells, so we must send them home on our unsignaled rail track yet again, without getting distracted by pretty biter barbecues too much, or the artillery trains will crash into each other. I said don't get distracted now, didn't I? And despite distractions, yet again the trains return home sequentially. But this time, we will immediately send them out again, so they can continue right where they left off. There, that's looking like four pretty perfect circles to me. Small, minor problem though. We have ran out of repair packs, it seems, so our bots can't repair at the front anymore. So, are the biters breaking through our walls already? Well, it seems not really. We also have some extra backup walls now in the form of radars. So that should keep them busy for a while if they manage to break through. By the way, if we look at the sprites count, we can see that just on this little wall section alone, there now lay over 10,000 dead biters. Extrapolating that to our entire wall, our own losses of 2.2k bots, 1.4k walls and a few stacks of raiders seem pretty insignificant in comparison. And just how much oil did this giant massacre cost us? Well, it looks like just 10k oil per minute for about 10 minutes or so. So about 100k oil in total. Given that we had over 500,000 of flamethrower oil in stock, I'd say we have enough to go ahead and further clear the map of biters. And we only spent 10k artillery shells to clear the four corners. That's amazingly efficient, given that we've taken out another 27,000 biter bases and worms. That's almost 3 kills per artillery shell. That unexpected artillery shell efficiency may mean that we have slightly overproduced artillery shells for the last 50 hours or so. Now, there is still plenty of biters on the map, and indeed, we may be taking out around 100k nests and worms today, but with the unexpected high average of kills per artillery shell, there's no way we are going to need the full 100k shells. So finally, let's shut down these assemblers then. After all that work, these assemblers may rest now. who may not rest though are the artillery trains. They still have plenty of work to do. After they arrived back in their respective corners, we just manually send them ahead a bit further down the streets. And... man oh man, the artillery trains are just erasing the biters line by line, like one of those old dot matrix printers. And not before long, our kill count passes 50,000 biter bases and 500,000 biters simultaneously. Beautiful. While the biters don't seem to be able to breach the full quad wall, I do see a little bit of smoke starting to emerge from my computer. They may still defeat me one way or another, because I've also run out of repair packs yet again. A serene calm has returned to our base, and our repair pack deficit is slowly catching up again. Well, let's clear the last section in a slightly less computer smoking way then. We have started to mass produce concrete for land-based artillery turrets. Our four trains cannot be everywhere at the same time anyway, so we will need them to keep enemy expansions in check. For now. One of those turrets fits exactly between each chunk of raiders, so we can just drag the blueprint down the entire wall. Yeah, it's a long wall. Still, only 67 turrets on this wall, so it looks like we'll only need 250 of them or so. And after blueprinting down the other three walls... oh! We are starting to melt the remaining biters away with logistic bot supplied artillery turrets. By the way, did you notice just how nicely Artillery Range 3 almost perfectly aligns with the edge of our current world? Finally, the artillery barrage has come to a rest. Any additional shells we want to deploy will have to be individually and manually targeted with the artillery remote control. And at the end of all this onslaught, we have ended up with an artillery Easter egg. And the only survivors in miles around is Johnny's redemption. here's our losses. And despite killing over 24,000 pollution factor pushing enemy spawners in this massive attack alone, the evolution factor increased by 0.3%. In the early game, you need to take out just a single BiterLess to achieve that same evolution increase. I am hoping that now you are looking at all the shiny arrows so that you don't see I overproduced 95,000 artillery shells. Anyway, that concludes our preparations for our grand finale to this series. We have placed the entire world under constant satellite surveillance, and we have cracked down on the biter protests with an artillery barrage of a never seen before magnitude. In revenge, the biters killed my UPS and probably nearly my computer. It will have to hold out just a little longer, so we can enjoy the grand finale to this ultimate DeathWorld challenge. We are well away on a mission to bring the only one true world peace to the ultimate DeathWorld planet of Norvis, which is of course by full extermination of any life form on this planet. But after all that automatic onslaught, now the going gets tough. So let's get going. Native life is still clinging on by a thread, existing in the twilight zone between the rich, green and artillery shell covered plains of Norvis and the deep, dark void of nothingness. We now need to find a way to convince the last remaining biters on the edges of the world to just fall off the face of the planet. Now, while the automatic artillery range cannot reach the remaining biters, the manual artillery range is much greater. That sounds like an easy solution, solvable in just a few thousand clicks. But there is a problem. You see, when we target enemy nests directly on the edge of the world, the artillery shell explosion bleeds over into the void, which generates and reveals a new chunk of land filled with new biter bases. We also cannot just walk in with a remote-controlled spider, as the spider itself explores a 5x5 area of chunks around it, which means the spider cannot come close by enough to fire at the biters, no matter what type of rocket it carries. As a quick refresher, in the past we have carefully determined the extent of the visible and hidden world generation in the void, and then proceeded to reveal all of it without generating any new hidden chunks. As of now, theoretically there are no more biter bases hiding in the black void, and I got several ways to check and prove that later. But while we can't carpet bomb the biter bases on the very edge of the world, there are still plenty of biter bases which are certified shell safe. So, let's start clicking! And soon the northern edge looks like this, just a thin red line of biter bases remaining. Now, due to the artillery range radius being circular and the map being square, we can't reach a large amount of biters in the far corner of the map, so we have to target all of these nests and worms by hand. The fact that this unreachable area outside of our artillery range squircle grows in size with every extra artillery range upgrade is an important reason we push the walls out further one last time instead of just researching more levels of artillery range in our existing base. And as it turns out, artillery range 3 lines up pretty well with the maximum radar scan range, which has led us to set up uninterrupted full satellite radar view with 20,000 radars pulling 6 gigawatts of power. So now we have to fire thousands of artillery shells by hand, with just a single misclick leading to near unrecoverable damage. An accidental newly generated chunk will throw several spanners in the works, as I'm relying on a perfectly square world border to execute my plan. So our main strategy is to carefully separate the problematic border bases from the inner safe nests before proceeding to spam click the large inner blob of biters. And then in the end, we can clean up by playing a game of click the red dots. But man, it is nice to have that full satellite view available. Imagine trying to do this in the fog of war from the map view, the map not being updated, resulting in not knowing which dots are the walking dead and which dots are nests and worms. This process would have been a lot more tedious. We are beautifully executing our Dark Forest game theory next to the Dark Forest of Novis. The relentless bombing continues through the night into the day. While the biters continue to pound on the weakest point in our defense, the distant southwest corner where the lake and forests converge all incoming biters into a single attack zone. But if they weren't able to breach our walls during the giant automatic artillery barrage, they certainly won't be able to breach the walls on their last dying breath. And meanwhile, we are 3/4 of the way in on going full squircle. We have discovered a remote inhabited island, and we can see the game will help us a little in getting rid of any nomadic biters. It seems that if the biters are no longer attached to a biter base, and they can't retreat to a different biter base, they tend to just despawn. Thanks game, that will help us a lot with the cleanup, I imagine. But Michael, you may say, you keep telling us there is no more land in the Black Void, yet I clearly see loads of biters wandering off and back onto the map. Clearly there is land generated beyond your imaginary edge of the world. Well, my man, you do have a point actually. The situation lies a little more complicated though. For now, we can regard the biter situation in the void as Schrödinger's biters. They both exist and don't exist at the same time. And for as long as we are not trying to force them into choosing a state, they will remain in a quantum superposition of both existing and not existing. It is only when we try to look if they exist or not that the superposition will break and they will choose one of those two forms. And just like Einstein once famously snorted, "Do you really believe the moon is not there when you are not looking at it?" The biters tend to choose to exist when you try to look if they exist. Well, no one can argue Einstein wasn't a smart dude, but we can try to get around the annoying breaking of the biter superposition by exploiting the wave-particle duality of biters. Just like in the famous double-slit experiment, where individually fired particles of light still form a wave interference pattern, and researchers have been trying to trick the quantum state of the photons by finding ways to indirectly measure the light in such a way that the properties of the light are not disturbed, we must try to find a way to trick the quantum biters by indirectly looking into the chunks in the void without disturbing the superposition of the chunk, so we can confirm that these chunks indeed are empty. So somehow we need to look into the void chunks without actually looking into the void chunks, as that will disturb the quantum state of the biters and cause them to fall into one of the two possible states. And as mentioned before, the biters tend to choose to exist when you try to look at them. Okay dude, so how the heck are we going to solve two higher physics problems in the game of Factorio? Anyway, the relentless bombing continues through the day into the night. And not before long, we are clicking the last lucky survivors who survived the initial carpet bombing. And while we rejoice in the fact that there is just a single thin red line of biters remaining at the absolute edges of the map, the biters embark on their fruitless final assault on our walls. The Great Wall of Norvi stands unscathed and has withstood the largest assault in the history of Factorio, with over 100,000 biters assaulting our base during the last few hours alone. Well, perhaps you cannot say entirely without a scratch. But our science production did not suffer at all, and we've been reliably outputting the full 94.5 science per minute for the last 10 hours now. Well, yeah, that's great and all, but that doesn't solve the problem at hand now, does it? How are we going to solve our quantum biter problem? Heck man, you haven't even found a way yet to clear the non-quantum biters, as those pesky border biters certainly are existing, alive and well. Well, back to our spiders. The white recluse's task is pretty simple. Defend the defenseless Black Widow with your 8 personal laser defenses. But why is the Black Widow defenseless? Well, because I outfitted it with 9 personal roboports. 9 personal roboports on 4 personal batteries? Are you serious? Don't you know how power hungry those roboports are? Why do you need 9 of them? Well, my friend, that will become obvious very soon. Alright, White Recluse, follow the Black Widow and defend him with your life. Meanwhile, some biter group which was on the way to attack us without any provocation from our side, forgotten their mission halfway through their march and are just standing there. That means our earlier observation of despawning biters doesn't apply if the biters go inactive for some reason. Anyway, our spiders have arrived at the outer wall, and as we send them to the very edge, this is it. If they take one more step, it'll be the farthest away from home they've ever been. Come on, spiders, it is time to step into the unknown. And we did reserve one little task for the white recluse, to draw a power line out to the edge of the world. And while the spiders embark on their journey, we manually take out an enemy expansion. A perfect opportunity to test the White Recluse's defense systems. Or is it? Only one of the biters makes it through. Two seem to have despawned already, and another one starts running back. And that one despawns too. Well, that wasn't really any representative defensive test then. We still have to look out to not run into enemy expansion parties. Another reason to be glad we have the Satellite Surveillance System 2000. Anyway, as the Black Widow approaches as close to the edge of the world as he can without generating any new land, we see the reason for the 9 Roboports. Every additional Roboport grants an increase to the area the bots can build in, and with 9 personal Roboports, the spider can just about place laser turrets far enough out to take out the last remaining biters on the true edge of the world. And most importantly, the lasers can take out the biters without generating any new terrain. Or are they? There are clearly biters emerging from the black void. Are those quantum biters which have just materialized into existence? Or is something else going on? I guess we'll find out soon. As we clear up the corner, we can obviously see the laser ranges extending firmly beyond what we currently believe is the edge of the world. Anyway, the big worms are outranging our lasers, so let's draw the laser line down to the nearest lake. And we can even see the lasers firing a target in the so-called empty void. This is getting more mysterious by the moment. And as we retreat, it seems like all laser firing has ceased, and peace and calm has returned to the area near the laser turrets. So let's make a save point, so we can finally perform our quantum biter experiment. Are there biters in the void, or are there not? Our laser turret range is clearly expanding 8 tiles into the void, yet they are not firing. It could be they just destroyed all targets already, but as you just saw, big worms outrange our laser turrets, yet we are not under attack. That means the chunk must be empty, right? The biters seem to not exist. Until we look if they exist with our Spidertron. Suddenly they do exist, and as we pause the game, the biters, biter bases and worms have literally materialized within the range of our laser turrets. Even though before we looked they were not there. Even when we were literally firing our lasers into the void earlier, these new nests didn't exist yet. But now the spider has disturbed the quantum superposition of the biters, and they now very clearly exist. And given some time, they'll completely obliterate our feeble laser turret line. But okay, I hear you. Spidertron literally looking into the void himself is obvious to generate and reveal new chunks. This doesn't prove much, really. We need to look into the new chunks without actually looking. So let's put our hazard concrete border to the test. We set that border for ourselves 20 chunks away from the edge of the world, believing it would stop further world generation. Let's put our assumption to the test. As I am currently riding in Spider-Man, we task him to carry us just a couple steps beyond our hazard concrete border. And suddenly our northwest laser turrets are in severe combat. Biters are emerging from everywhere, and after the first wave calms down somewhat, we clearly see there now exists worms into the void, which are outranging our turrets and attacking us over the entire northern line. And we're starting to lose turrets left and right. And indeed, while standing at our current location beyond the hazard concrete border, we can confirm our suspicions with our theoretic world border blueprint, which predicts terrain is now slowly generating in the background outside the revealed part of the map. And as we reveal the entire world by commands to verify, our theory is confirmed. One extra row of chunks has now been added to the world, but only one extra row. This means that before we cross the border, one less row existed, matching our previously predicted world border. In fact, we also stated that the background world generation isn't instant, but generates at about one chunk per second. So let's step out one chunk to the west to see that process in action. Okay, let's see that one more time in slow motion. First, the south lasers activate. Then, the adjacent chunk pops into existence, and we can literally see big worms materialize on the previous edge of the world. Now they exist, our lasers quickly kill them, as well as a bunch more worms and nests supposedly generated with the new chunk. So, let's reveal the whole world again by command, which indeed reveals the previously ungenerated column of chunks, with big worms now destroying our lasers on the entire west flank. The fact that the very corner chunk is not generated further strengthens our theory about the background map generation, as we were never in the chunk directly northwest of our hazard concrete corner, and thus the most northwestern world border chunk still does not exist. Anyway, obviously another way to mess everything up is by wildly flinging artillery shells into the void, so let's not do that. Let's end this experimental session and reload to our real playthrough. The version of this world where the lasers sit idly on the world border, unbeknownst to the fact that hordes of biters could materialize within the range at any careless moment. So let's continue with care then. Meanwhile, I have made another set of landfill blueprints to cross the lakes with the spiders, keeping the landfill a safe distance away from the actual chunk border. As long as we keep the spiders in the third chunk from the world border, we should not generate any new chunks in the process. The biters keep trying to make new expansions all the time, but our full square of land-based artillery turrets at our walls make quick work of those. So we continue the short distance down south to the next lake. Our lasers suffer heavy damage and even get destroyed now and then, but it doesn't matter. Collectively, they get the job done. The only thing that we need to be careful of is the power line connection. If that breaks, it will cut power from all the lasers and leave them as sitting ducks. To minimize the chance of that horror scenario happening, replaced thrice the substations needed in our blueprint, meaning that any two adjacent substations can be destroyed without interrupting our power line. And as we reach the lake, we quickly check back to see if any of our laser turrets are still fighting the enemy or getting destroyed by big worms in the void. Fortunately, that's not the case, so it looks like my plan will turn out to be a great success. Of course, one should never celebrate too early. So, let's bridge that lake, and in fact, let's pre-place the landfill blueprints a good ways ahead. All seems to be going very well. But not before long. Yeah, we reached the limitations of carrying around 9 roboports with the bots flying out their maximum distance all the time. The spider's personal batteries are already empty. I'll be back. So we might as well send them back to the base to restock on supplies while the personal roboports and batteries recharge themselves. Meanwhile, we load up Spider-Ben with 9 roboports as well and give him a whole bunch of repair packs. We will repair those unsightly damaged laser turrets for the same reason as we blew up the landfill with atomic bombs earlier. It looks nicer on the map. Yeah, it takes more time to repair than to replace. Spider-Man will have to take it a little more slowly. Meanwhile, the black and white spider's batteries are fully recharged, so we can send them back out again. Unfortunately, we cannot place more batteries in their armor, as we need a fusion reactor for the power and the full 9 roboports to reach the world border. I foresee this power problem may come back to bite us in the bottom at some point. The spiders continue on their way down south, this time with much better cinematography. Hey, I'm learning these techniques as we go along too, man. Armed with our landfill blueprints, even crossing these kinds of marshland archipelagos are no problem for our spider team. And soon we reach the southwest corner. As the spider team runs out of battery power for the second time, we need something else to do. So we decide to finally get rid of our old, obsolete inner wall. Soon the bots are swarming all over the place and we slowly see the old wall and turrets disappear. And not before long, our spider team is continuing on the south section of the laser turret extermination wall. Thank you. Man, this is satisfying to watch even from the map view. And we got Spider-Man trailing behind with the repair packs now. Actually, there even is another way to check for the presence of biters in the dark void. If we switch on the enemy expansion chunk view, we can see all valid locations for the biters to make expansions. As a rule, these locations extend up to 7 chunks away from every existing biter base. Before we started the laser cleanup, we had a full square of expansion chunks around the map. But now, the expansion chunk candidates are disappearing as we push forward with our laser turret extermination line. Hey, I almost forgot we had a base. Another set of rockets is preparing to launch. But they don't launch just yet. The simple circuit condition we set to just keep up with yellow signs causes the rocket launches and thus space science production to automatically synchronize with the other science packs. It has been working surprisingly well for such a simple and hacky solution. Oh no, an enemy expansion blocks our way. White recluse, this is your time to shine in all your nighttime laser lit glory. Ha, that's pure brutality. We just plowed straight through them like they weren't even there. Man, this is something new. Everything is going exactly according to plan. I can't believe this is all turning out so well. Anyway then, I think we can safely skip ahead now to when the whole square of lasers will be complete. Wait, what is this? Why do these lasers keep on firing? What is going on? Oh no! Something somewhere went horribly wrong. It seems there are biters and worms here in the void everywhere. We cannot see them, but we can hear them. And what a perfect timing to completely run out of battery power. But I don't understand, how can that be? So far my theory has worked perfectly fine on the other three sides of the map. Did I miscalculate something? It seems not. The world border blueprint is perfectly aligned with my hazard concrete border. Hazard concrete border. Hazard concrete border. Wait a minute. Yep. I have been walking beyond the hazard concrete border, right in the area where I neglected to place the hazard concrete, because I would never need to be there anyway. And truth be told, I did have no business being there, if OCD hadn't been working its dirty magic. Oh man, there could be tons of biters in the Eastern Void everywhere again. How the heck are we going to solve that problem again? Well, at least the biters have calmed down after we retreated our laser turrets, so after our investigative period of disbelief, now we can proceed from the denial phase to the ignore phase. So let's just call the spiders back home and call it a day. Well, ignoring the problem isn't going to help to solve it, so let's use our world border blueprint to assess the maximum extent of the damage. Since obviously we cannot have walked on the water, we can assume the maximum biter generation distance ends in this chunk, and a Johnny in the Void loudly screams he's indeed very much not a quantum worm anymore. But as no biters are being triggered by the laser turrets just south of us, that's a good indicator that the chunks adjacent to the laser turrets indeed have not been generated. Well, that or there is just more lake next to the turrets. Anyway, the northernmost point we could have possibly trespassed on happens to align perfectly with our X+20 marker. Now, assuming this is the only time we trespassed, that means the quantum biters now have materialized several chunks deep over a vertical distance of about 40 to 50 chunks. How the heck are we going to solve this problem, man? I really don't want to repeat the entire shenanigans of moving the whole effing west wall further out and start the entire biter elimination process from scratch again. We are going to have to find a different solution. So, like any good engineer, we are going to postpone the problem by going the long way around and coming in from the other side. And now that we have properly learned to work with our laser turret elimination system, we can be a little more efficient with it. So, while the spiders approach, we can already lay out all the landfill blueprints to the northeast corner. And prepare the laser line to the lake. We can then send Spider Ben, who is now the cliff exploding and landfill spider as well as the repair spider, to the supposedly safe space in the middle of the lake, while the laser laying black spider trails directly behind. So that should lead to a final cool and professionally controlled shot before we take on the unknown Eastern Quantum Biter Void Chaos thing. Good enough. Okay. Yeah, that's gonna take a while again. But we made it to the safety of the middle of the lake. While the spiders recharge, we can have a zen moment to ponder on how to solve the problem, while glancing over our base a bit and removing a few completely dried up mines from the early game. You know, 50 hours in. Anyway, the first problem we need to solve is on how to get full satellite radar vision on the extra chunk beyond our radar scan range. Those were not in the planning. Then it hits me. We obviously need to automate fusion reactors and legs. And rocket launchers. What? How is that gonna help us? Oh, right. Those are all parts we need for more spiders. More spiders is the solution for exactly the same reason why we can't approach the world border with our existing spiders. They grant a 5x5 chunk area of map vision around them. So we can basically plant a few stationary spiders to act as remote, local raiders. Meanwhile, our existing spiders' batteries have recharged again, so we start to approach the northeast corner. Now, as the accidental newly generated chunks are pretty close to the northern edge of the map, we need to be extra careful in how we approach this. So this time, let's prepare well. We send a spider spy of our own down south to prepare all the landfill. Now, Spider-Man is completely defenseless, so we need to carefully dance between wandering expansion parties and stationary assassins hiding on the trail. Wait, what? They don't even move. Then we shall shell them again. Perhaps they were decoys. Anyway, all seems clear for Spider-Man to go ahead. Meanwhile, we lay out laser turrets a good distance further south than where we believe the newly generated land starts. We will sacrifice those turrets to find the true new world border hidden in the void. But first, we gotta clear out the final corner. I can't get enough of these sites. After all visible biters are gone, the lasers are no longer under attack here in this corner, which is a good sign the lands beyond are still empty. Now we go for the way down south. Let's find out where those pesky biters are hiding out in the void and where not. Alright, it looks like we found it. We're going to need some help to deal with it though. So let's prepare ourselves to build some spiders. Now, if you think these are just going to be stationary spiders, you are wrong. They will be our stationary raiders in the end, but first they shall be deployed for our final war on the biters.
Thank you.
Now that's an army. But man, that's a lot of gear we need to hand insert in each of these 10 spiders. Do you hate manually inputting gear into each and every one of your 10 spiders? Not to worry, listen to our guru. Doctors hate him for this one organ implanting trick. Yep, you can copy-paste spider gear from your inventory into their equipment grid. And while our enemies, the bots, will blot out the sun with their arrows and rockets, then our spiders shall fight in the shade and make their own light with 2800 explosive rockets each. This is Norvis! Alright spiders, deploy tactics! And march! Now that is an army! So we need to send our spiders out into the unknown of the void. Alright, after all my careful land generation preparation, this is incredibly scary to do. But an engineer's gotta make others do what an engineer's gotta do. So spiders, there you go. Alright, initial penetration successful. With 5 rocket carrying spiders basically stacked on top one another, we can just face tank all the hits while their combined 20 rocket launchers make quick work of anything biter. Now we gotta be careful to not enter the next chunk, as that will generate even more land. Now we just force march down south until we hit the lake. So the spiders' rockets cannot reach the world border, but dealing with large artillery revenge attacks is a bit dangerous for our nearby weak laser turrets and the slow defenseless builder spider team. So let's call the spiders back up again to intercept any artillery revenge party the biters throw out. So yeah, perhaps a bit expensive on the rockets per bite ratio, but hey, it seems to work, at least in this little test corner here. So let's see if we actually revealed all of the accidentally generated terrain then. It is a little awkward to lay out the inside corner, but thanks to spider waypoints, we can automate the spider walking around at the correct distance. Let's see how it goes. Oh man, that is a lot of biters though. But after they are eliminated, suddenly everything is eerily silent. And it seems that all is quiet on the eastern front. Okay, test corner successful. Now let's see if we can take on the big boys with this strategy. Yeah, I don't know why I sent Spider-Man down south to pre-place all the landfill earlier. Obviously, we gotta make new landfill strips next to the new world border. So let's see if we can establish a foothold south of the lake. Hey, not bad at all. We may be able to just push this group of spiders all the way down south. Or maybe not. The front spider is taking all the incoming fire and is about to die, so this is gonna be a two-shift job. Let's call in the next shift while we send the first shift back to the Builder Spider team for repairs. We are halfway through, and it seems we have reached a clearing in the endless flood of biter bases. The trips from base camp are getting longer and longer, so perhaps we'll restation at the clearing and set up advanced base camp over there. So let's regroup and heal up before we make the trek to advanced base camp as a team. Yeah, so I kinda forgot our builder team doesn't have quite the same speed upgrades as our Red Spider Assault teams. And to make matters even worse, the Red Spiders draw the attention of hordes of biters before staving off in the distance. Spider-Man and the Black Widow are unshielded and defenseless, and I'm not sure the few feeble laser defenses of the White Recluse are suited to take on this many biters at once. We quickly call back the Red Police Force, but they arrive on the scene too late to be of any use. The White Recluse got the job done herself, but lost at least a dozen bots in the process. And I guess she'll take out the last straggler biters on the way as well, before the Red Spiders catch up again. Anyway, advanced base camp has been reached. Let's push further down south to the lake, which is the theoretical endpoint of the extra generated hidden biters. Nice. The spiders push down south a little too far though, and in doing so confirm that we predicted the extra land generation correctly, as suddenly a big worm has materialized on the peninsula, which is now firing at my laser turret line. Anyway, eventually all of our spiders successfully reach the southern gather point. All of the hidden biters have been revealed yet again, so you think we'd be almost done with just the cleanup remaining? Well, you'd be wrong. This is the point where things start to spiral out of control into pure chaos. Embark with me on this experience where I stack one mistake on top of the other until the whole mountain of mistakes comes crashing down. First of all, right here on the water with the biter bases bending back at an awkward angle, this is not a good point to install a corner with our laser turrets. We should just generate a few extra chunks to the south instead and install the corners on the land. But we don't. Instead, we position our red spiders in the predicted path of the artillery-triggered biter revenge attacks, because thunderclouds are packing together above the biter bases yet again. As there's no land generated beyond what we can see again, the biters will be forced to bend around the northern side of the lake, right into the path of the Red Spider assault team, and that should prevent huge groups of biters from attacking our weak laser turret extermination line. Nice. So they're grouping up for the attack? Come to daddy. Hey, where are you going? Now what? Well, I guess they gotta come back at some point, right? We have time, we can wait. In the meantime, we shall shell them some more. What? How the heck did they get on that side? And why is the world border diagonal now? Oh, the artillery shells are coming in at a 45 degree angle and are generating new chunks in the void. Anyway, so the next recording file name is called A Pretty Bad Plan and an Even Worse Execution. So strap into your seat and tape your jaw to your nose to prevent it from falling to the floor in sheer disbelief of events to come. Alright, so our laser turret line is unsuitable to deal with artillery revenge attacks, but the northern side is clear, so I guess these northern nests can be safely bombarded as the biters have a free horizontal path to my quad wall flamethrower defense. Meanwhile, diagonal artillery fire from the south has generated even more chunks, and newly materialized worms are now demolishing my laser turrets. But where are all the revenge attack biters? They should be visible on the map already on their way to my walls. Man, I'm really missing my satellite view in these newly generated northern chunks. Well, let's use some artillery shells to take a quick peek. Wait, why are all these biters parting down south? Uh-oh, I think I'd better start saving my laser turrets while I still can. Well, too late. I gotta be careful with my spiders, as a biter group this size would make quick work of my spider builder team. Just look at them gobbling up my lasers. Okay, so where will they go next? I cannot see them in the fog of war. Ah, where is my vision? Okay, well, that answers that question. How the heck am I gonna stop a group that size? Just look at them gobbling up my lasers. I have no other choice but to take drastic measures. We need to send in the red spiders to deal with this. But that will generate even more chunks filled with biters. Unbeknownst to me, amidst all the alerts, the defenseless Black Widow has almost been gobbled up by a group of biters. We manage to save him from their jaws and proceed to deconstruct and save what we can. But where are the white recluse? And Spider-Ben. Ah, fortunately they're still safe on the landfill strip, protected by the other Red Spider Assault team. Well, time to regroup and rethink. Well, the regroup part went okay, but the rethinking part? Don't ask me about it. I agree we should probably just open more land to align the world generation with our walls to prevent more unexpected diagonal artillery fire. But a smart guy would have deconstructed the laser turret line there first. We tried to call over Spider-Ben and the White Recluse too, but hordes of biters blocked the way. And again, a group of behemoth biters is gnawing on the Black Widow. This time though, the Red Spiders do help him out. But Spider-Ben and the White Recluse have become separated from the group. And there's no way they'll make it through all the biter activity between them. Let's hope no biters pass through that thin landfill strip, because all the laser turrets there are gone. After a while though, the coast seems clear, so let's have them make a quick dash for it through the wasteland. And instead of monitoring the spider's safety, let's focus on watching this biter's attack instead. anyway, all the spiders made it safely to the south side. And thanks to this lake bending up diagonally to the north, this location seems much more appropriate for our laser turret corner. But we'd better proceed with a little more caution from here on out. I don't want to go through this entire ordeal again. So we a little more cautiously reveal our new corner and confirm the lake indeed extends how it looks it does. But finally, the spiders are now standing in a safe location, out of the way of the area between the biter bases and the artillery trains. We can safely shell the hell out of the remaining biters now and let our walls deal with their revenge. So, for old time's sake, let's watch the last biters explode into oblivion. So this is what it would have looked like without our satellite radar view, waiting for the shells to reveal the map at the last moments before impact. And then being left with this mess of red dots on the map. Of course, we can try to update every single chunk with artillery shells all the time, but I honestly think setting up 20,000 radars was less work than doing this all over the map. So, it's time to try and gain ground with our laser turret extermination line again. But boy, after this mess, the Black Widow is carrying a lot of damaged lasers now. Fortunately, we've got our old trusty spider band to repair them. And to prevent further mistakes, instead of trying to start with the awkward south corner, let's come in from the north side, where we can just continue our laser line straight down south. While the spiders march north, let's give all chunks a final update now that the biters have calmed down again. And of course, I hit the single worm which survived a little further out, causing new biters to run amok all over the place. I'm glad we did the rest of the map under our satellite view, man. So, let's prepare for the final laser installment line. Taking a peek at the expansion chunk candidate circles, which extends 7 chunks out from every single generated biter base in existence, we can confirm again that the new north corner is indeed clear of biters. And it looks like some biters indeed did part over our landfill bridge. Good thing they didn't do it when our undefended spiders were hiding out there, man. So, by now you know the drill. The landfill has been placed, so let's stamp down our laser blueprint next to the world border, get the white recluse to defend the Black Widow from any straggler biters we may encounter, and march south. And as the spiders extend the laser line down south, they are clearing the last remaining biters in existence on the entire planet of Norvis, and we can see the last remaining expansion chunks disappearing from the map. And when the spiders approach the Southern Lake laser connection point, we have finally achieved our goals and dreams of world peace. For completeness sake, we connect our laser turret loop to form an uninterrupted band of 8,000 laser turrets all the way around the edge of the world. And then proceed to spread out the red spiders to give us full satellite view on the outcrop of the square. But due to the unexpected extension, we actually have to make 5 extra spiders to fully light up the outcrop. And here's OCD's final kick in the butt. I just need to spread all the spiders out equally, which means moving this spider one chunk south on that tiny island under there. And in doing so, the spider nearly wobbles into the adjacent chunk, almost generating new land yet again. Man, this series has had enough finals, so let's zoom out and never touch these spiders again, shall we? And wielding our world border blueprint a final time, we can indeed confirm the new world border lines up with the top right nuclear explosion scorch mark. Hey, let's not make that same mistake again, shall we? Let's make the base bots install what should have been installed from the get-go, a nice hazard concrete border. On the outskirts of our old starter base, we say our final goodbyes to little Johnny. We couldn't save him, but Johnny's redemption lives on, carrying forward the legacy and making sure the injustice of the past shall not be forgotten. Ah, yes, our humble starter base, which got us barely up to blue science and enough firepower to break out of our first prison. Our single minimum production oil source, which single-handedly dealt with an entire ultimate DeathWorld's amount of enemies. And of course our first rocket silo, which launched 100 rockets up to space. And wait a minute, this is literally unwatchable. The hazard lines on the rocket silo's doors misalign with the hazard concrete. Our full minimum pollution base is visible in this shot, except for the steel and green chips, which are brought in by what every Factorio base needs the most. A giant train network. Well, anyway, our steel production is still going strong, and there are no kinks in the copper cables at our green chip factory. Our full pollution output is sustainably sustained almost entirely within our walls even. Just a mere 50 hours ago, we were at the peak of industrialization, reaching the highest pollution levels ever measured on this planet. Since then, we have bettered our lives, and 25 hours ago, we reached minimum pollution output which the local nature could reliably scrub without ill effects on the local flora. The local fauna, however, is a different story, as we all have been able to see from the comfort of our chairs through our uninterrupted satellite TV connection, provided by a massive wall of 20,000 radars. Thanks to those, we have been able to enjoy the grand extermination of the biters in its full glory, and even now, we could easily expand the factory with bots without ever leaving our walls, delegating direct instructions to the most distant corners of Norvis, comfortably from our Spiderband command center. We still have plenty of resources available to keep on surviving and thriving for a long time. Our double speed, minimum pollution oil fields have been providing the bulk of the oil works. Every oil processing refinery has completed 20k to 40k cycles, whereas the coal liquefaction plants have done only 7k each. In fact, we haven't even touched that 12 million extra coal patch yet. Speed modulated infinite oil production should not be underestimated. Science production hasn't missed a beat for 20 hours now, and checking the number of completed cycles on the assembler level confirms the system has been running like an atomic clockwork. The biter evolution reached an incredible 99.38%, which is pretty rad for standard DeathWorld evolution progression. We had to kill over 64,000 biter spawners to push the evolution factor up that high. The 97,000 worms we killed don't contribute to the evolution factor, and neither do the 586,000 biters. The early game immense time pressure factor contributes a mere 6%, despite this game taking over 134 hours. We have deliberately not researched any of the space science requiring infinite damage upgrades to our weaponry, to better show off the power balance between the different endgame weapon systems and the maximum evolution biters. All of our space science has gone towards the 3 levels of artillery range we required, robot flying speed 10, and the rest was chucked into the great mining productivity test. Taking a look behind the scenes in the map editor, we can indeed see Schrödinger's biters do not exist in the void. However, the first land chunk in the void has been fully generated, but no entities like biters or trees have generated on the land just yet. Looking further beyond, 3 chunks of rough land shape has been generated as well, which explains why the biters could pathfind around the lake in the void to attack my laser turrets instead of falling into the red spider trap. Now, the map view in the editor won't generate any new chunks, but if we quit the map view and physically move right in the game view itself, we can and will generate new biters as we approach. Uh, hand, as we physically approach the world border, we can see new biters generate where there previously were none. And indeed, the green enemy expansion circles have returned to the map with them. As we zoom in, we see that the newly generated biters have indeed spawned within the range of our laser turrets again. And as soon as we progress a second of time, the lasers and the biters start to attack each other. We reload, and before celebrating our victory, we do a quick check to see if indeed all enemies are gone. But to our horror, discover there are still 34 enemies remaining. Where could they be? After some searching around, we find a handful of these spawnerless but inhabited islands. Fortunately, there's a local weather forecast of heavy rain expected, and the biters quickly disappear into nothing. Only 8 entities remaining now. Where could they be? Of course, it's Johnny's redemption. Gone are the big words of how they will carry forward the legacy and shall not be forgotten and blah blah blah. True world peace can only be reached in one single way. To be the only life form left on this planet. The game could just as well be set up to be biterless and peaceful, and you wouldn't be able to see the difference. But, as we admire the fully pacified planet of Norvis, we come to a startling conclusion. It's too quiet here. I don't like it here at all. So, we fire up the Legacy rocket silo a final time. Take Spider-Man with us in the rocket. And we get the F off of this lifeless planet. Blech. Wait. Something's wrong. Uh-oh, that can't be good. Oh, where am I?